of like coffee. Like, is coffee good for you? Is coffee bad for you? And doesn't it seem like every other day you're getting a new piece of research about if it's good for you, if it's bad for you? So the diode laser has certainly been one of those pieces in the hygiene arsenal where there have been a lot of questions.
Hello, friends. I'm David Rice. I'm your chief editor here at Dentistry IQ. Gloves off. Katrina Sanders, how are you?
I'm so good. How are you today?
I'm great. And this is another true like gloves off tale we're going to tell today. So question for you, do diode lasers even really work on the hygiene side?
Oh, man.
Well, I mean, we gotta, let's just go there.
Let's just go there, shall we? Wow. Okay. This is a very provocative question when it comes to clinical parameters, because we continue to see swinging back and forth, differing pieces of information. It's kind of like coffee. Like, is coffee good for you? Is coffee bad for you? And doesn't it seem like every other day you're getting a new piece of research about if it's good for you, if it's bad for you? So the diode laser has certainly been one of those pieces in the hygiene arsenal where there have been a lot of questions. So I think the first piece in all of this is looking at what it is that we understand about statistically significant research. So this is where I ask hygienists, you know, if I told you that there was a procedure that you could do on a patient and it was successful 31% of the time, like, is that enough for you to do that procedure? That procedure, by the way, I'm talking about is the inferior alveolar nerve block, which, by the way, according to Stanley Malmed, is really only successful anywhere between 31 to 81% of the time. And yet how many of us do IA nerve blocks and then wait for that failure to happen? And then we go, all right, well, try something different, right? Try a different lower block. The idea being, when we look at how we institute our care, when we look at the reasons why we put fluoride on our patients' teeth, the reason why we take, why do we take radiographs every year on all of our patients? Why do we do that? There's absolutely no piece of research that says that you should take x-rays once a year. We know that we should be looking at Cambra, caries management by risk assessment, and we shouldn't just be taking x-rays annually because the insurance company covers it. We should be taking x-rays annually because that's the patient's risk, if that's truly accurate. And so I wanted to begin with that provocative idea because I think we tend to split hairs as hygienists when we start to infuse or integrate new modalities into the practice. When we look at the statistical significance of how diode lasers have been used and the research around the success of a diode laser, I think it's critical for us to understand that if we're going to split hairs about this laser, we should also be looking at all of the other areas of what it is that we're doing and making sure that that is being integrated in an evidence-based modality. So that's the first provocative piece. We always have to get a little provocative on the show here, right? So
we have to
unpack that. But let's talk about diode lasers. So we know, at least in the hygiene chair, we can use in most states the diode laser on two major practice modalities or settings. The first is LBR, or laser bacterial reduction. The second is LAPT, laser assisted periodontal therapy, where we are initiating the tip, utilizing a different wavelength, and the tip of the laser then becomes a magnet to attract any infectious granulation tissue. So when we take a look at the research as we have it, a few things are really critical. We have seen, there are plenty of pieces of research that say that these lasers target specific wavelengths that help to reduce the concentration of bacteria or help to provide resiliency to that cellular epithelium for healing. We have seen that research. And yet there's the other side of that coin, which is, do we see that improvement in clinical practice, right? And so we use this model of, this is what the research says, and this is what our experience has been in clinical practice. We use those two things together to create or surmise our thoughts around, does this actually work? Is it worth it for us to charge the patient a little bit extra to integrate this type of a therapy, et cetera? But the one piece that I do want to remind dentistry, and that is, how do you measure inflammation in your patient. And this has really been a critical piece. I think most hygienists, most dentists will say, we measure inflammation by if the patient is still bleeding and what the pocket depth number is. But every other profession measures inflammation by gathering a blood sample and looking at inflammatory cytokines and C-reactive proteins. There's a whole world of inflammation that we in dentistry are not measuring. And yet we also understand during this global health crisis that we were concerned about the generation of aerosols. And we acknowledged that pre-procedurally, perhaps there are things that we should have or could be doing to reduce the amount of bacteria that can enter the bloodstream during our procedure and can reduce the amount of bacteria, viruses, yeast, spores, funguses that get released into the air when we're integrating aerosolized procedures. So the idea being, when we look at diode lasers and the provocative question of, do they actually work? I think the major question to ask is, what is it that you're wanting these lasers to do? Are you wanting them to reduce viral load in the air? And if so, we know that they do that. But how are you going to see that clinically show up in your practice, a result-based piece? You know, are you wanting to reduce the amount of inflammation? How do you measure that? Are you gathering bleeding sites and gathering a bleeding index on your patients to see that overall trend move for your patients? Yes, diode lasers do work, not just laser-assisted, you know, procedures associated with perio, but we've seen lasers being used for TMJ biomodulation, for example, that we've seen lasers being used in muscular issues in the practice. And so, you know, I do think that there's an opportunity for lasers. It's all in how we're integrating this into our practice, how we're identifying the right clientele for it, and subsequently how we're continuing to maintain a laser treatment protocol within our practices.
Like it. So measurement, I think that's a really key point to say that as we look at inflammation in dentistry, we look at it very differently than everybody else measures it and assesses it. Do you routinely assess it in another fashion, or do you, knowing what you know, say, I'm getting out of my laser therapy what I would like to get out of my laser therapy?
Yeah, that's a fabulous question. So I work in a periodontal practice. So we work with a lot of inflammation. And I will say our protocols are relatively standardized unless we see an outlying patient where we'll step outside of that boundary. We work very closely with the Mayo Clinic here in Scottsdale. So we do have patients that just based on what you see on their health history, you know that they're an inflammatory nightmare. And we all know what some of those types of clientele are going to look like. Your rheumatoid arthritis patients, your cardiovascular patients, your diabetic patients. These patients are going to say things like, I had another stent placed in my heart. My vascular surgeon is concerned about some of the microclogs or clots. So we know that endothelial layer is just like firing on all cylinders. But we also measure inflammation in other ways. Women who are stressed out, those cortisol levels hike up. So we see high levels of stress there. So we are, higher levels of inflammation rather. So we are screening for patients that fall into a category where they're going to be higher risk for inflammation. That's a critical component. And yes, we do gather that as a risk assessment number. So we can quantify that within our practice. In addition, our protocols in our practice, you probe every tooth, every site, every time, except for the patients that, of course, have been through flap or laser-assisted osseous where they're in a healing period and we shouldn't touch those areas. But other than that, we probe every tooth, every site, every visit, every time. And so we are constantly monitoring those changes in inflammation. We're you know, evaluating for changes in that epithelial layer. We're looking for changes in that bleeding tendency. And of course, that's another multimodal component to what we do. And we do salivary diagnostic testing. So we are looking for the different types of bacteria that we know have an ability to elicit that inflammatory response. But I will say, and you kicked open the door to something really interesting, the American Academy of Periodontology has just now added a new section to the grading component. We in dentistry, I believe, will at a very short time in the future be expected to gather C-reactive protein markers and use that inflammatory concentration as a risk factor. Many of us are doing blood draws already. I'm phlebotomy certified. I do blood draws so that when doctor wants to do PRP or PRF, that they're, you know, able to gather that blood sample. So we're going to start seeing this trickling through practices. I think, you know, some of your, you know, more biologic practices, your higher end practices, your perio practices, they'll probably be the first to measure that level of inflammation. But how wonderful would that be for us to then look at, you know, you had diode laser treatment. This is what your inflammatory markers looked like initially. After treatment, this is what your inflammatory markers look like. What a dramatic change. And our goal is, as Dr. Tim Donnelly says, he's one of my favorite doctors. And he says, you know, our goal is we want you to walk around with as inflammatory free of a periodontium as possible. That's our goal. We want to get you down in inflammation. And so really that's where we look at, how do you measure it? How do you evaluate it? How do you treat it based on the patient need?
I love it. So friends, if you are not presently incorporating laser into your therapy, it's worth a look. And if you are, yay you for getting ahead of the curve. I think we're about trend setting here with gloves off. I'm not positive, but I'm pretty sure. Anyway, Katrina, thanks for being with us. Friends, thanks for listening in today. We'll be back next week. Cheers.
Thank you.